Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this second episode of OrthoTV Original on Postgraduate Education. And I'd like to welcome our speaker, Dr. John Ebnezar. And he'll be speaking today on examination of the hip joint. And this is the part one of these of the examination presentation. Welcome, John, sir, and over to you.
Thank you. Good evening. I welcome all the students to this very important talk on hip examination. And this is our second lecture of the postgraduate education series, initiated by Dr. Ashok Sham. And I can assure you that the first talk had a good response, and more than 1,500 students have watched it and they have liked it. Thank you very much. So we'd like to continue with this series. And today is this very important topic, examination of the hip joint. It's my approach. And this is part one because it's quite extensive. And I want to go slow and try to educate you about this aspect of the orthopedic examination in greater detail. So this is in two parts. In part one, we'll cover the introduction, the applied anatomy, the exposures for the examination, history taking, and the three types, that is general examination, systemic examination, local examination, which is 18 steps. In that, we will be covering part of the local examination today, if not complete, and then we go on to the part two, the next step. So let us now begin by selecting these five layers around the hip. Thomas, you go. You know about this famous Thomas test, hip flexion test. Maria Ortolani, he was the one who described the test for CDH. Paulo Thomas Jeffrey, Schindelberg Frederick, the Milton, Morris, King, Sir Henry Gawain. These are the pioneers who have done significant work and contributions for the hip joint examination. Clinical examination is a dying art. In current times, diagnosis is investigation based and not clinical based. No one has the time and inclination for the detailed and marathon hip examination. Clinical examination has now been reduced to only passing the practical exams. This is all the more a reason to respect and remember these pioneers who immortalized the art of clinical examination of the hip joint. Our hip is the remarkable piece of structure created by God. We need to know our hip joints before you know everything about examining it. Hip is the biggest and most stable joint of the human body. It has got the pelvis, it is formed by two elongated planes, and each one is comprised of the ilium, ischium, and pubis. You know about the involved and globular structure, which is one half hemispherical in nature, articular surface covered by a thick articular cartilage. There is a ligamentous release which connects the femur connect to the head via the femoral neck. The normal angle of inclination is approximately 135 degrees. This angle is somewhat decreased in women and thus leads to overall angle changes. The angle of torsion is the forward angle relationship of the head and neck. The angle of retroversion is normally in the 12 to 15 degree range. A stem, a depression or fossa where the femoral head articulates. It is positioned in a downward and outward direction, surrounded by labrum, much like the glenohumeral joint of the shoulder. The labrum is thicker and more substantial superiorly than inferior, which corroborates with the weight-bearing nature of the joint. And you all know there are two trochanters, greater and lesser, distant to the femoral neck. On the shaft of the femur is the lateral projecting big trochanter and the medial projecting lesser trochanter. These sides serve as primary attachment points for the pelvic and hip musculature. And the other important bony landmarks, which are important for the examination of the joint, is the anterior superior iliac spine, the iliac crest, the posterior superior iliac spine, the ischial tuberosity, and the sacroiliac joints. Other joints associated with the hip joint, that is the pubic symphysis. Here are the pelvic bones articulate anteriorly at a fairly immobile joint. This is formed by the fibrocartilaginous interpubic disc. The movements that occur at this joint are strong but very necessary. They include spreading, compression, and rotation. SI joint, the posterior articulations occur at the SI joint. And the muscles around the hip, the hydrocephalus group, which brings about the flexion of the hip joint. And this is the two joint muscles of the hip and knee. It works both at the hip and the knee. It is rectus femoris, which is a hip flexor, and it makes up a part of the quadriceps group too. Then you have our sartorius, which flexes the knee, contributes to flexion, abduction, and external rotation of the hip. Then we have the hip extensor, the gluteus maximus. Adductors and abductors of the hip, gracilis, the adductor group, which has got adductor longus, magnus, brevis, they're all the adductors. Then you have the gluteus medius, which is the primary abductor of the hip. If the compensating movement is termed the trendle impulse gait pattern, the tensor fascia data is part of the elliptical band. Then the external rotators of the hip, this is brought about by the cuff muscles of the hip, the piriformis, quadratus femoris, obturator internus, externus, gemellus, superior, and inferior. Then you know about femoral triangle, the boundaries, which is formed by the inguinal ligament, the sartorius laterally and arrector longus on the medial side. And this is an important clinical mark, landmark, which is used as a reference point. Parts of the femoral nerve, artery, and vein are located within this area. The femoral pulse is palpable here as well as a lymph node if there is an infection or inflammation in the lower extremity. Bursae around the hip joint, the trochanteric bursae, it lubricates the site at where the maximus passes over the greater trochanter. Then you have the gluteofemoral bursae, it separates the maximus and the vastus lateralis. Then you have the ischial bursae, it serves as a weight bearing structure and the patient is sitting. An important neurological structure is the sciatic nerve, which is located midway between the greater trochanter and the ischial tuberosity. It can be palpated by going halfway between the tuberosity and the greater trochanter. Then you all know the movements of the hip. So there are a wide range of movements in the hip joint. The movements may not be as much as the shoulder joint, but it's a stable joint and the movements are, you know, are flexion, extension, abduction, or action. And you can see that the normal flexion is around 0 to 130 degrees, extension is 0 to 15 degrees, abduction is 0 to 40, abduction is slightly less, 0 to 30. External rotation in hip flexion is around 0 to 45 degrees, internal rotation in hip flexion 45 degrees, external rotation in hip extension is around 45 degrees, internal rotation in hip is 0 to 35 degrees. Biomechanics of the hip joint, it is loaded in the following manner. Normal load distribution in symmetric support, the double leg stands, 50% of the weight of each head. By standing, there is one third body weight on the head of the body weight. And walking, even 1.5 to 5.5 times into body weight. Walking staircases is 3 body weight. And running is 4.5 to body weight. So this is the biomechanics of the hip joint. And this is how the joint is loaded. You can see that the load is maximum when it is running and walking stairs. At least when standing on the two legs. So, we have this breathtaking activities on hip joint. It's a remarkable piece of engineering marvel by now. You can see the movements, what can be done if you have a good hip. It's quite breathtaking. Get a chance. Everyone would like to see and examine hips like these. Beautiful hip joint. Everyone wants to have a go at these kind of hip joints, examinations. But in examinations, you don't get those kind of hip joints. What you're going to get is these kind of hip joints. You don't like to examine these, but this is what you're going to get in your exams. The ungainly hip joints, the deformities are what you're going to see. But if you examine these ungainly hip correctly, a bumper prize awaits for you. What is it? It is your MS Ortho or your postgraduate degree, because in practical examination, hip case is your MS and MS Ortho is your degree. Such is the importance of hip examination for you. Whether it's university exam or a national board exams, invariably the law case that is going to be given to you is definitely going to be your hip joint. So if you master the technique of examining the hip joint, it is as good as you getting your MS of the degree. So that's what, you know, that is why I place a lot of importance for this particular joint, and this is surrounded with lots of controversies, which I would like to discuss with you and clarify. So what's the approach? I'll speak about my approach. So you'll have a fairly a balanced idea of how you should be going around examining the hip joint. I cannot speak for others, so I want to speak how I do it. Hip is a three-letter word. A series of hip cracks I'm going to describe to you will help you understand and remember the issues. The clinical examination of the hip. So let us begin, my dear students. Before we start, you understand the simple screening test to rule out the hip problems before we begin. Ashok, are you able to see it?
Yeah, we are able to see it, sir.
Yeah, fine. So simple screening test to rule out the hip problems before we begin. What are those? Can the patient stand erect? Can the patient squat on the ground? Can the patient sit cross-legged? If the patient can do all this, or tomorrow in your practice, when you see a hip joint case, if the patient is able to do all this, that is standing erect, squatting on the ground, sitting cross-legged, then the inference is patient has no major hip pathology. So this is a simple screening test to rule out hip problems before we begin. Unraveling the mysterious hip. In a nutshell, my approach. First one, position, drape, exposure. Extremely important. Listen, that is your history. General physical examination, which gives vital clues. Systemic examination, which will give further clues. Local examination, which is look, feel, move, measure. Look is inspection from the front, sides, and back. Feel is palpation of various structures in and around the hip. Movement of the hip joints, measuring the limb length and measuring the hip joint, are the part of local examination. Then you have got a plethora of special tests, which you should understand and execute well. Then you need to analyze. You need to put everything in an order. Then comes a probable or a provisional diagnosis. Then comes the role of investigations, which will help you to make the correct diagnosis. And then you will call the final diagnosis or the differential diagnosis. Then is the management protocol, the rehabilitation protocol, and the discussion that will follow. So, how to unravel the mystery of a disease hip? Well, it is all in the word HIP, that is H-I-P. That is history, inspection, palpation. Proper exposure, key to success in hip examination. As a surgeon, when you later on become a surgeon, you know the value of proper exposure. Your surgery, the success of your surgery depends on how good is your exposure. So in examination of the hip, your exposure of the hip is very important. The success in the examination of the hip joint depends on the proper exposure of the hip. What I call as the hip exposure triad. That is position, lighting, and draping. So the patient is either on the flat bed or on the table, away from the wall, free or round, so that you can move all around the table or on the bed. And then hands should be by the sides, head should be resting on a pillow. And the anatomical position, the knee extended, hip neither flexed nor extended, lightly adjusted so that it is ideal. Draping, both hips should be adequately exposed. Patient is either in the supine or standing position. And you need to examine the patient from the front, back, and sides. So this is very important. Students should not rush to examine the hip joint without exposing it properly first. So this is how you should go methodically, step by step. So this is the first thing, the hip exposure, the position, lighting and draping. So remember this as a triangle, which I have drawn a triangle to make you know better. The challenges hip throws are true. No other joint demands so much respect for exposure as the hip exposure is a challenge. Why? Because it's a deep joint. There is no easy surface markings here. Thick muscles and soft tissue coverage is very essential to have adequate proper exposure. Part below and below the mid thorax should be exposed. Too close to the private parts. Hence, proper exposure is a problem, especially in Indian females. It's very difficult because you have to convince a lady to allow her to examine you. If you get a young lady in the examination hall, then the challenge you are going to have is going to be quite enormous. So the private parts to be covered with a T-bandage or a small underwear. And most importantly, female attendant is a must. Never examine a female patient without an attendant or the relative of the patient by your side. So these are the things you should keep in your mind when you expose your hip for examination. Proper exposure will help you to examine the hip properly and you will not miss mark with the vital points. Then, once you expose the hip properly, now is the time to examine the hip. That is, you have to start the examination, the hip joint. So, it is about listening, looking, and moving. What is that? Listen. Listen is nothing but history. History. So, you have to listen with both your ears open. Listening is an art. History taking is not a dry art. Don't be mechanical while you are taking history. By taking proper history, you will come to know what the problem the patient is suffering from, and that will enable you to reach your diagnosis almost with accuracy, full accuracy. So it's not the art. You should learn the art of history taking. If you ignore it, history taking, it's at your own peril. It's not just form filling. History taking is not just form filling. It is an art. Listen to his story. History is his story or her story, depending on who you get, male or female. So you have to listen carefully. Put it, you have to try to understand the patient's language and put your questions in the patient's language. Each complaint what the patient has got has been dissected. You say that each symptom should be sucked dry. You should suck each symptom dry. That means each and every complaint has to be dissected thoroughly when you are taking history. As you are taking the history, plan your examination and keep thinking about the diagnosis. So, history taking is very, very important. So, history taking is still his story or her story. The patients are going to tell you their complaints. So, that complaint is his or her story. And that is the story before one. It is his story. So you have to listen properly and you have to interpret properly. Then you have to listen to his story of himself, what I call his personal history. Then what he has got to tell about his family history, his story of his family. Then what is that he has to tell you about the treatment he has taken earlier? What is his story all about, the treatment what he has received? Then story of allergies, what he has. His story of birth, valuable especially when you have congenital problems like CDH, DDH, all those kind of things. And immunization, now very important. And that will give you a clue as to the immunity status of this gentleman, of the lady, who may suffer from problems like tuberculosis, etc. And if it's a patient, her direct history, menstrual history, all those kind of histories are going to be very important. Now, so you understood the value of history taken. Now let us see what are all the histories you are supposed to take. Again, a triad. I have formulated various triads in the joint. Hip is a three-vector, so I have got so many triads. Now, here also we have got triads in the history. One is present history, past history, and other histories. So the present history, past history, other histories. Other histories are the family history, social economic history, personal history, occupational history, and the treatment history. And the sequence of events in the examination leading to what is the diagnosis is this. The patient's data, initially, then the history, then the general physical examination, then the systemic examination, then the local examination, and then the diagnosis. History, not just one, but many. Present history, duration. Then, you have to know how to take the present, the history of presenting complaints. Just knowing the presenting history is not going to be important. You are going to take the history of presenting complaints. Then the past, the personal, the family, then the treatment, allergy, immunization, OBG, which I have already told you once. Before taking the history, look into these for diagnostic possibilities. What is the age of the patient? What is the sex of the patient? What's the occupation? Nationality? What is the education? And the socio-economic status? You may be wondering how this is going to be important. Here it is. Now, the age is not just an age. Genetic examination, it gives away a vital diagnostic clues for you. Like, say it's a bird's eye view, for example, in children. If the child is going to seem to find this of age, then usually it's going to be a diagnosis that ADH, the dogs will have arthritis or tuberculosis synovitis. If the child is between 5 to 10 years, the infections are the herpes. If the child is between 10 to 15 years, slip capital tumoral devices, infections, herpes or cysts. 50 to 35 years range. AVN, secondary warning, ankylosing spondylitis, fractures, elderly people infections, OA, secondary OA, and fractures. It is not necessary that, you know, this will be in this order only, but in most of the cases, it follows this protocol. If the, in young adults, I use the mnemonic stare, these are the conditions where, you know, the patients may suffer from these conditions like spondyloarthropathies, post-traumatic events, AVN, post-infective conditions, impingement, mild arthritis, and in late adulthood and beyond, ERIOT, that's the mnemonic, AVN, rheumatoid arthritis, infective arthritis, OA, and trauma. So, age gives away vital diagnostic clues. Don't ignore that. Then, sex. There is sex predilections. The females will find the systemic lupus erythematosus and rheumatoid. Males, spondyloarthropathy, then the slip capital femoral epiphysis, tuberculosis, herpes. It may vary. It may be different. You may find rheumatoid in males too, tuberculosis in females too, but this is the prediction what the disease has. Then, the typical hip complaints. Now, we'll have to look into the complaints in order of importance. First and the foremost is pain. If there is a pathology in the hip joint, the pain is felt in the groin, most commonly, rarely referred to the thigh and knee joints. Then, the patient will have night pain, especially tuberculosis. Limb is the second most common complaint, gait disturbances. Early warnings in rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, swelling in and around the hip joint, limb length discrepancies, deformities in and around the hip, inability to squat, inability to walk, activities of the daily living limitations. So these are the hip complaints what the patient may have. Now, pain. What to look for? Remember the mnemonic, old right. What to look for? Onset. Is the onset preceded by trauma? Fever. Where is the location of the pain? Is it in the groin, thigh, or the knee? And what is the duration of the pain? Is it an acute condition or a chronic condition? And what relieves the pain? Does the rest relieve the pain? Activity relieves the pain or causes the pain? You have to be very specific. Intensity. How severe is the pain? Mild, important and severe. Patient have got various adjectives to describe the pain what they have. They may say biting pain, gnawing pain, intense pain. They may use any number of adjectives, words. Progression. Is the pain progressing? What exacerbates the pain and what relieves the pain has to be questioned too. And if the patient says that there is a radiating pain below the knee joint, then be on guard, because that could not be a pain arising from the hip joint. Second most complaint, the limb. The onset of the limb should be asked. What is the duration of the limb? How severe is the limb? Progression, walking affected or not affected, associated or not associated with pain. And you should note that next to pain is the limb, which is the second most common complaint in the hip joint. So, if it is a limb, either it could be painful limb or a painless limb. The mnemonics TIID for the painful limb. What is that? Traumatic conditions of the hip. Inflammatory conditions of the hip, like rheumatoid arthritis. Infective conditions, like tuberculosis. Degenerative conditions, like OA. So these are the painful, you know, conditions which can cause limb in the hip joint. Then, now we have got the painless hip. CDEPA, what I say. Coxavella. DDH. OU. Ankylosed hip, knee, and ankle. So these are the causes for painless hip joint and painless limb and painful limb and painless limb. I'm sure now you have got this right and that you will not confuse anymore. The third complaint could be morning stiffness. The duration of the morning stiffness gives you a clue of probable diagnosis or possible diagnosis. If the morning stiffness is more than 1 hour, the likelihood of it being rheumatoid arthritis is definitely more. If it is less than 1 hour or 30 minutes, then the diagnosis usually could be osteoarthritis. Again, please remember, nothing is dogmatic here. This is just a observation, a generalization. You can have different, you know, presentations in the disease. So nothing is hard and fast. But this is generally speaking, you know, this is 1 hour and less than 1 hour. That applies to all the complaints and all the findings. What we are going to discuss, we always tell in common what it is, but it can happen otherwise too. So don't be very dogmatic in thinking that because it is this, it has to be this. No, you have to come to a conclusion overall. Swelling. What we should focus on? Where is the swelling? What is the onset of the swelling? What is the duration of the swelling? Where is it? Whether it's the region, whether it's in the groin, whether it's near the trochanter, whether it's in the gluteal region, or it's the medial side of the thigh. Where is the swelling? Very important. We need to know. Then, is it associated with pain, or it's a painless swelling? And how is the swelling? Is it progressing? Is it getting enlarged and bigger? That has been questioned to the patient. Then, limb length discrepancy. The next complaint. Is the limb short or long? Is it on one side or both sides? What is the duration of this discrepancy, limb length? And is there any pain? Progression. Is it progressing? And then, is it associated with limb? That is the limb length discrepancy. And other complaints like inability to squat, inability to walk, deformities around the hip, loss of function of the hip joint. So, this was all about the present history. And be slow, be quick. If you follow this method right from the beginning, then you will be doing it very fast in examination. You know what is to be asked and how you should dissect each complaint will be, you know, a cakewalk for you if you have practiced it right from the beginning during your student days. Past history. We are told not to brood into the past. Always, philosophically, and we are told don't look into the past. Always look into the present or into the future. But not so in the examination of hip joint. Here, the past history is very important. It is relevant. Past history of tuberculosis. Past history of any bleeding, diathesis. Past history of trauma. Past history of drugs. Patient taking steroids. It can give you a clue that it could be dealing with aortic stenosis. and any surgeries the patient has undergone earlier and any systemic illness. That means past history is not just past, it is going to add a lot of value into the present. So you have to really look into what is that you're going to ask with the past history of the patient. Then, family history has a relevance. It gives you valuable clues. Tuberculosis, okay. History of family history of tuberculosis, spondyloarthropathies, gout, rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis. So the patient has got this history, their family members have suffered from these conditions, then the genetic factor comes into play, and it may be one of the important factors which can give some clue. And socioeconomic history, it indicates the predilections. How does the patient reach average, poor, or below poverty line? There are some socioeconomic histories like tuberculosis is a disease of the poor. So it will give you an idea if the patient is very affluent and very, that it's unlikely that patient could be suffering from a malnutrition or a chronic infectious conditions. The patient could be having AS or necrosis or something like that. If the patient is poor, malnourished, then the chances of the patient having tuberculosis is high. Like that, the socioeconomic has to close light onto the diagnosis. Then the treatment history. This also gives you a valuable information. Patient may say, I was suffering from tuberculosis for which I've taken treatment. Or patient may say, I got spine tuberculosis for which I've taken treatment. And the patient may tell about some chronic hip or spine conditions for which the patient has taken treatment. Then you have to ask the regularity of treatment. Especially tuberculosis, whether the patient has taken the chemotherapy correctly. If not, there is every chance that the disease has not completely healed and the disease could have spread or the joint or bony parts or different bones and cause the problem. And what is the duration of the treatment? And did the patient have any complications and side effects following the treatment? And then what were the previous surgeries, if any, if the patient has undergone? It's better to inquire on that. Then comes the personal history, smoking, duration, quantity, alcohol, quantity, and the quality, the diet history of the patient, the sleep history of the patient, menstrual history in females, the bioelectronic tuition, the sexual function, the occupational history, and most importantly, stress is what to be inquired into. So this is about personal history. Now, at the end of history taking, if you have taken the history correctly, if you have taken the present history, past history, family history, socioeconomic history, personal history, then treatment history, then almost the diagnosis is framed in your mind. You know what you are dealing with. So, what is the nature of the disease? Is it acute, what you are dealing with? Or is it subacute? Or is it chronic? At the end of history taking, you should be able to place the disease in one of these categories. Then, what is the type of the disease you are dealing with? Is it post-traumatic or non-traumatic disorder? And then, if it is a chronic condition, what you are dealing with, then where does it fit in? Is it a congenital problem? Is it a metabolic problem or a developmental problem? Inflammatory problem? Intellectual problem? Degenerative problem? Or whether it's malignancy? So, at the end of history taking, you should be able to place the diagnosis somewhere in this particular three things which I explained to you. Then it will make your further examination fairly simple. But after history, it's going to be examination of the hip joint now. The scheme, get this right, the scheme. Vitals, general examination, systemic examination, local examination. In local examination, you've got gait, and then inspection, what we call look, that is feel, that is palpation, then in movement, that is move, and finally measurement. If you follow this scheme, then there is a very less chance of you missing anything while doing the hip examination. Now, relevant general examination has to be done from head to toe. Don't be casual and don't be fast and don't be ignorant while you are doing a general physical examination. It should be from head to toe. Look for anemia, jaundice, cyanosis, loose flea, lymphadenopathies, cachexia, hepatosplenomegalies, chest expansion, thyroid swelling, nail, clubbing, pitting, high arch valve, ectus excavatum. What is the importance of these? The vitals are important. General examination is not general. It can lead to something very concrete and help you to localize your diagnosis. Systemic diseases, it will help you to make a diagnosis of systemic diseases, what the patient is suffering from. It also helps you to get the surgical fitness if you are planning surgery on this patient. That is the value of general examination. Then, next is systemic examination, which gives vital clues to the diagnosis. The CNS has to be examined, the CVS has to be examined, the respiratory system has to be examined, follow abdominal examination, genitourinary system, and colorectal examination is one of the very important examination method which students try to avoid as much as possible, because they are not very comfortable doing a colorectal examination, but it is very vital component of the systemic examination. Now, after general examination, systemic examination, it is time for local examination. The cardinal points in the look, feel, move, and measure. Local examination, I put it under steps. It's an 8-step method. Step 1 is inspection. Step 2 is palpation. Step 3, percussion. Step 4, auscultation. Step 5, hip deformities. Step 6, movements. Step 7, measurements. Step 8, specialists. Now, when you are into local examination, you will have to follow all this 8-step method to be spot on the diagnosis part. So, step 1, inspection. What is it you need to look? What is it you need to inspect? What is the gait of the patient? And what is the position the hip adopts? What is the attitude? This is what I'm going to look in step 1. So let us begin with gait. Inspection triad, look. What is that you're going to look? Again, the triad, overall and specific. Overall, you're going to see from the front, from the side, from the back. And specifically, you're going to see the gait, the limb length discrepancies, and fixed deformities. So in inspection, this is what you're going to do. You're going to see all this. Now, first look at the gait of the patient. Very, very important. During examination of the gait, the following point should be noted. Can the patient walk? Is the patient gait bipedal or unipedal? Is it assisted or unassisted? Does he or she walk in this straight line? Does he or she fall? Does he or she walk with a limp? If so, does he or she lurch towards the affected side? Possibly, if the diagnosis, observer or senior, or does he or she lean towards the sound side, the arthritis? Or does he or she waddle or lurch on both the sides? This is what you need to see. And then, is the patient carrying a walking stick and holding it? And is it in the same hand or in the opposite hand? So these are the initial examinations, what you are going to do when you are going to examine gait. So normal human gait, it is bipedal, biphasic, forward propulsion of center of gravity, in which there is alternate sinuous movement of head and body with least expenditure of energy for propulsion and maintenance of the center of gravity. Simplest definition of gait is mode of walking. So you should understand the normal human gait before you understand the abnormal human gait. If you don't know what a normal human gait is like, then it is very unlikely that you understand what the abnormal human gait is all about. And in the examination, invariably the students get stuck in the gait examination. They will not be able to describe the gait properly, and the examiner will go on meddling with the student, and there is so much of confusion taking it off. So spend a lot of time understanding gait, and you will see various types of gait. Then only you will be able to analyze the gait properly. And you know the phases, stance phase, switching phase. 60% of time is stance phase, foot is on the ground, heel stroke, wing stance and push off. 40% is in the swing, foot is not on the ground, and the swing phase goes through acceleration, swing through and deceleration. Now, the pathological gait. Know these as they offer an insight into diagnosis. Types and likely causes. Is it an antalgic gait? Could be painful conditions of the hip. Is it a short hip gait? Short limb shortening. Is it Kendall-Wilbur gait? Failure of the upper arm mechanism of the hip joint. Is it a gluteus maximus gait? Weakness of the gluteus maximus. Circumduction gait. High stepping gait. Indoor gait. Gait in bilateral hip problems. There you have circumduction. Is it a stiff hip gait or a stiff knee gait? So these are the pathological gaits. Limping, as I told you, is the most common abnormalities. It can be defined as any abnormality of normal, rhythmic, biphase walking. This is the biphasic walking. What a normal person has. It is painless, whereas in limp, it could be painful. We can compare these two types of walk. Here is the normal walk, and here you can see the limb, right? My patient is lurching on the normal side, okay? And if the patient lurches to the affected side, it will be this possibility for diagnosis for disease. So, the limb has to be observed carefully. And then, antalgic gait. It's a short stepping gait. The step length is asymmetrical and less on the affected side. Stance phase is decreased on the affected side and increased on the normal side. You can see here the stance phase is more on the normal side. Swing phase, unaffected, leg is brought forward more quickly than normal. Patient wants to walk fast, patient wants to pass off the stance phase on the affected side. So that is about antalgic gait. Next. There are famous, the famous 17 causes of antalgic gait. The overall 17 causes and the common causes. The overall 17 causes for antalgic gait are the following: pelvic girdle pain, juvenile idiopathic arthritis, trauma, fracture, bone infection, bone tumor, herpes, osteoarthritis disease, collars, bone disease, leg cramps, Lewy's muscles, arthritis, head trauma, knee trauma, foot trauma, ankle trauma, blisters in and around the foot and the ingrowing nails. These are the overall causes of antalgic gait. But what are the common causes? Infective conditions, inflammatory conditions, and then early herpes, acute slip, and then trauma. These are the common causes of antalgic gait. Then the next gait, what we need to know is the Kendall-Wilbur gait. Kendall-Wilbur gait is a non-painful limb and is indicative of proximal muscle weakness or hip instability. The causes could be weak abductors, defective fulcrum, defective liver. We'll go into this detail when I go into the Kendall-Wilbur sign, Kendall-Wilbur gait, we can discuss this more. And in Kendall-Wilbur gait is the problem of the fulcrum, liver and power. It's a functional weakening. There could be functional weakening of the abductor mechanism, abductor muscles at mechanical disadvantage, standing on the affected side, pelvis dropped to the normal side to compensate. You can see that the lunge is to the affected side. No need to compensate. Then the lunge could be to the opposite side. Characteristic pattern, the step length and the stance phase are equal. So this is the Kendall-Wilbur gait. So it's a problem of the fulcrum, liver and power. Did you know or do you know other names of Kendall-Wilbur gait? They may ask you in the exams, or you may get as MCQs in your entrance exams, or short questions may be asked. So the other names for Kendall-Wilbur gait are the dip gait, lateral bending gait, and then gluteus medius gait. So these are the synonyms of or the different names of Kendall-Wilbur gait. And proximal gait versus Kendall-Wilbur gait. You can see here the lurch you know, is on the affected side, but the contralateral hip drops. Whereas the coxal GPA, lurch is again on the affected side, but the pelvis is level. So this is the difference between Kendall-Berg and coxal GPA. Then you have got the short leg gait. Here, hip hiking is the hard part. The shift is to the same side. Pelvis is tilted downward with a dip. Equal period on each side. Supinate foot or toe walk. Next, knee and hip angle normal side. Hip hiking. The pelvis rises on the normal side. The skin face to where the ground. So this is the characteristic features of the short leg gait. In one hearing, you may not understand all this. You have to repeatedly go through all this, repeatedly see the patient, examine the patient, discuss with your friends, colleagues, teachers to understand all this gait very thoroughly. The hip hiking is the hallmark of short leg gait. Then you have got the gluteus maximus, weakness gait. The gluteus maximus, here the terminal swing is to the opposite side. Gluteus maximus locks hip in extension on weight bearing side. Weakness, pelvis thrust forward and run backward. The shift of center of gravity backwards. No force, need to lock. Increased lordosis, lunge back and forth over the hips. This is the characteristic features of gluteus maximus weakness gait. And what are the names? Names for the gluteus maximus gait: jackknife gait, lurching gait, posterior trunk bending gait, kicks gait. So remember these, the different names for gluteus maximus gait. The high stepping gait is very easy to diagnose. You all have seen foot drop and how the patient with foot drop walks, and it's very, very easy. Of all the gait, I feel the high stepping gait is the easiest to understand and to interpret. And you should know the other names for the high stepping gait. It is also known as Russian march gait, dragging gait, or equinus gait. So these are the different names for the high stepping gait. Then the genu-recurvatum gait, paralysis of the quadriceps muscle. Patient cannot stabilize the knee in early stance phase. Hence, the knee bends backwards. Compensation is by gastrocnemius, soleus, and gluteus maximus muscle. And then you have got the hand to knee gait, what we call as the quadriceps gait, or five finger quadriceps. Seen in post polio patients, paralysis of the quadriceps muscle, weakness of the gastrosoleus complex, weakness of the gluteus maximus. So, while buckling knee, patient bends anterior. Then you have got the best calcaneus gait. Here, patient uses entire sole or push off, seen in hammer toes, metatarsal here. Then you have got the push off gait. Weight is mainly borne on the heel. Entire foot leaves roll simultaneously instead of the roll from heel to toes, seen in tendo-Achilles rupture. Then in-toe gait, when child walks, feet point inwards instead of straight ahead, commonly called as pigeon toe gait. Causes could be metatarsus adductus, tibial torsion, femoral and diversion. Abnormal gait due to CNS problems, cerebellar gait, trunk or willing gait, wide base, unsteady, irregular gait. Then circumflexion gait, also called as hemiplegic gait. To clear the ground, the limb goes around a laterally curved path. And you know about this Parkinsonism gait, the bastinet gait. It's a quick, short steps or shuffling gait. Trunk bent forwards, arms flexed and legs. Paraplegia gait, also called as scissors gait. Seen in spastic paraplegia, crossing of legs in the front. Coliform gait, seen in sedentary hand scoria, abnormal, slow, rhythmic movements of the body. The neuropathy gait, seen in sensory neuropathy conditions like diabetic neuropathy. Sensory ataxia gait, poor sensation, poor muscle coordination. Broad base gait, feet are flat against the ground. The patient stamps the foot on the ground. Gait is irregular, jerky, and wheeling, similar to space walk. Crutch gates, swing crutch gates, swing through, swing to. 4-point crutch gate, 2-point crutch gate, and 3-point crutch gate. The 4-point gate is the safest gate, used when patient unsteady, when patient is unsteady, requires wide base for support. The maximal support by crutches requires weight bearing on both the legs. Move right crutch ahead, 6 inches, then the left foot forward at the level of the right crunch, then move the left crunch forward, then the move the right foot forward as patient's balance improves, progresses to 2-point crunch gait. And the 3-point crunch gait, it requires weight bearing on the unaffected leg, move both the crunches and the weaker leg forward, move the stronger leg forward, or the patient moves the stronger leg forward first. It's a faster gait, most commonly used in orthopedics. So this is the 3-point gait. Then you have the 2-point gait. It's faster than the 4-point gait, requires less balance than 4-point gait. Patient is partially weight bearing on both the legs. So then move the left crutch and the right foot forward together, then move the right crutch and the left foot forward together. All of the patient does like that, amount of body weight taken on both limbs is reduced. Swing two gait, usually used by client with paralysis of both the legs. Prolonged use results in atrophy of the unused muscles. Move both crutches together. Lift body weight by the arms and the swings to the crutches at the level. Then swing through gait, move both the crutches together, or patient moves both the crutches together, lifts body weight by the arms and swing forward ahead of the crutch beyond the level. So now this is a quick recap of all the gaits which I have discussed so far, the characteristics, the highlights of important gaits, antalgic gait, the span space is less, short limb gait, hip hiking, gluteus maximus gait, backwards lunging, pendulumbar gait, lurch towards the unaffected side, high stepping gait, the foot drop, scissoring gait, cerebral palsy, waddling gait or sailor's gait, bilateral hip problem, stiff hip gait, there is no hip flexion, quadriceps gait, limp with the hand on the knee, calcaneus gait, there is no push off phase, stiff knee gait, pelvic raise on the swing phase, ataxic gait, the legs are wide apart. I think we'll stop here now. We are already 50 minutes into the discussion. I think we can take questions here now. And then the next episode will have the discussion further from this point where we have left. Ashok, I invite the questions from students.
Yes, sir. First of all, thank you very much. That was really comprehensive talk.
Thank you, Ashok. Thank you very much.
Yeah. So there are some questions that I will be conveying to you directly. So
okay.
I'll start my video too. Okay. There's also Dr. Dhruv Gupta who has joined us. But let me begin with the question. So their question first about history taking. So how should we ask the question of alcoholism to the patient? What question should we ask him?
Okay, very important question, sensitive question. You will have to be very, very diplomatic when you ask the alcohol question so that the patient will not become uncooperative towards you. Just ask whether the patient has got some habits. And then habits, when it does involve, like smoking or issue with alcohol. And then be gentle, and the patient says yes. Then you say, when you are being alcoholic, and what is the quantity you have been taking alcohol, and then what is your social drinking, or whether it has become an addiction, and all those type of things. If you are empathetic and if you are not critical, a patient will usually be very cooperative with you. If you are critical and judging the patient, then probably the patient will be hostile towards you. But very empathetic, you are just asking in the best interest of the patient. The history, I don't think it should cause any problems in the asking whether the patient has got any alcohol habit.
Right. So the corollary to the question was, what is the significant history for alcoholism and smoking that we should consider as this is a important significant history?
In so that means you are trying to ask me what is the significance of alcohol in hip pathology?
Not really. What is the significant history that the patient gives in terms of duration and the dose of alcohol and smoking?
Okay. Now, the significance is the patient says he's a chronic alcoholic. Right. When the patient is chronic alcoholic, usually the patient will have some associated habits too, like smoking or drugs. or the patient can give you history of fall, repeated falls because of patient being alcoholic. So that is significant. So post-traumatic histories, you may elicit from the patient, and that could be related to alcohol. Or with the alcohol, the patient could be a smoker too. If the patient is a smoker, then the chances of ADL and all the diseases are quite significant, and also tuberculosis for that matter. So definitely the alcohol history and the smoking history will add to your knowledge, and it will help you to understand what is the type of patients you are dealing with, and it will definitely give you a very leading clues to come to a diagnosis in such type of patients.
Right. Another question was how to ask the history of tuberculosis.
Tuberculosis, how do we ask?
Yeah.
Well, you have to ask whether, when you are asking the past history, you have to ask whether the patient has got cough, fever, evening rise of temperature, and loss of appetite. And if the patient's access in the upper medium, then you should ask whether the patient had any issues with the respiratory tract, whether the patient suffered from a chronic lung disorder. If the answer is yes, then was it tuberculosis? You could have third or fourth question would be the leading question like tuberculosis. Then if the patient says yes, then you should ask then whether there is a family history. And if the answer is affirmative, then whether the patient has been on treatment, whether the patient has taken proper treatment, and whether there is any dropout in the chemotherapy, what the patient has, and is it associated with some other skeletal tuberculosis like spine, hip, ankle. You have to just ask all these questions if you want to know whether the tuberculosis has a role in this patient or in the patient, what is given to you.
Right, sir. I think Dhruv has joined us. Dhruv, you have some questions?
Welcome, Dhruv.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, I would
thanks
just
for
like...
joining.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for a wonderful session. I would just
thank
like
you.
To ask you, sir, that in the Trendelenburg gate, sir, there is a difference between the Trendelenburg lurch or in the Trendelenburg gate. So how do we answer that question and explain it?
Right. See, Trendelenburg gait, I am going to take in detail in my next session. There is quite an in-depth analysis I have done about Trendelenburg gait. I am going to show you a lot of slides on Trendelenburg gait and a lot of mechanisms of Trendelenburg gait, because Trendelenburg gait is one thing which is definitely going to be your waterfall in the exams. I had a tough time answering Dr. Puri. He was asking me so much on Trendelenburg, which I didn't know at all. The what we know about Trendelenburg gait is only that it is a hip abductor mechanism of abnormality. But yes. We don't know that it is quite in depth, the Trendelenburg gait. So just hang on through. Now what I've told you just about Trendelenburg gait, because I discussed it as a part of different gaits, what we may come across. But Trendelenburg gait cannot be answered just like that. After I go through the entire presentation on Trendelenburg gait in my next session, then you can ask all your doubts on Trendelenburg gait.
I look forward to it, sir.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Dhruv. So there was another question,
sir,
about tuberculosis. How to ask the history of Cox contact?
How to ask history of Cox contact?
Yeah.
Yeah. See, now once the patient says yes, I've got pulmonary problems, something like that. See, then the immediate contact will always be the patient's family.
Right.
Like if the patient has got tuberculosis, it is very likely that somebody, how did the patient contact? Maybe first doubt is in the family, then second is his surroundings. So you have to ask, if the patient says, I have got tuberculosis, I got chronic cough more than 3 weeks, evening rise of temperature, then you should definitely ask, is anyone in your family suffering from this condition? There should not be any hesitation in asking that, because if the patient says yes, then it is very obvious that the patient contacted it from his family. If the patient says no, then ask about his work. Where does he work? And whether anybody in the workplace is suffering from chronic cough, and where is he coming in contact with that kind of a person. And then ask what is the occupation of the patient. Suppose he is working in a hospital. working with in a sanatorium, something like that. So it is, you know, it gives you the idea, you know, as and how you go on asking the questions. First the family, then the then the friends, the relatives, and then his working atmosphere will give you the clue about your interest.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I think Dr. Avin has joined us, but I think his laptop is causing an echo. Dr. Avin.
I think Dr. Avin has joined us, but I think his laptop is causing an echo. Dr. Avin. I think Dr. Avin
has joined. Can't hear. Okay, so there was another question on how to present. Many times examiners ask to give a diagnosis after history taking. So how do we say our diagnosis, a provisional diagnosis on history taking, at the end of history taking? How do
yes, at the end of history taking. Now, after going through various types of history, then you should come to a possible diagnosis. Like, what is that you're dealing with? Is it an acute or a chronic problem, which I told you? Then, what kind of problem it could be? Is it traumatic or post-traumatic? And if it's a chronic disorder, what you are dealing with, then where it fits in? There's a congenital problem, developmental problem, tuberculosis, or inflammatory conditions, or any other conditions what you're thinking of. So, based on how the patient presents to you, patient may tell, I have pain, limb, and then restricted movements, deformities, and the patient has got a poor socioeconomic history, and the patient has got a past tuberculosis, then you can say that you are dealing with a chronic hip problem. The patient, the examiner may ask, what chronic hip problem? Then you should not say suddenly tuberculosis. You could say it could be an infective condition. What infective condition the patient asks? Suddenly don't say tuberculosis again. You should say chronic infective condition. What it could be? Possibly, it's a mono articular joint, it's a younger or a middle-aged person, and it has got a history of all these, then probably it could be tuberculosis. That is how you should come to a conclusion.
Right.
On history taking, you come to know that it's a chronic hip condition, and it's a painful hip condition, and if the patient says that he's had a chronic asthma in the past history, and if the patient gives a history, the treatment history, the patient says, he has been taking a lot of steroids and all this, and then it gives you an inkling that maybe you are dealing with a condition called aneurysmal necrosis of the femoral head. So you can say again, I suspect there's a chronic pathology in the hip joint. The examiner says, what kind of pathology is suspecting? Then you can say that it could be an inflammatory condition, or it could be a chronic, or an aneurysmal condition, what the patient could be having. And the patient, the examiner said, why do you think so? Because one, it's young patient and he has definite history of steroids. So I possibly think that it's a chronic condition or a secondary OA or AVN. Like that. So if you can analyze the history properly, somewhere the diagnosis will fit in. The patient has to be in any of these conditions only. It cannot be outside this condition. And if the patient says, right from beginning, I have got the problem. Then you are dealing with, maybe you are dealing with childhood problem, then maybe you are dealing with the upper teeth. Or if the patient is an adolescent and the patient has got a hip problem and it has the latter into other, then you could suspect like the femoral epiphyseal problems. Like that, you definitely help you to come to other conclusion. If you have taken the history meticulously and you have not eliminated any part of the history, then your diagnosis more or less not even implanted in your mind. And that is how you can tell the examiner, sir, the presenting is the same thing, the past is the same thing, there is corroborative evidence, the past history is supporting the present history, and the family is supporting the past history, and his socioeconomic history supports this, and then the treatment history supports it. Overall, we are dealing with this kind of a condition, which could be an acute or a chronic, and a post-traumatic or a non-traumatic. And then, or any of the chronic pathologies which I enumerated about.
Right, sir. Another was a question from Avin. He joined us some time back. He's asking, do we present examination of SI joint and spine before the hip examination or after the hip examination?
I think so. It should be after, not before.
Right.
That's what I feel. I don't know what Ashok, what you feel, but I feel that you have to first present your hip joint examination. Other joints always come last.
Right. I agree with you, sir.
Yeah.
There is another question. It's not a question. It's actually a request of taking the general examination in detail. How to measure the different points that you raise and how to report them during the exam. Because many a times it is overlooked, but sometimes the examiner asks in detail about certain things. So there was a request of taking the general examination in detail, which will be applicable for any long case.
I am happy that one student has, you know, shown importance or shown interest in this general physical examination, because usually we tend to overlook it.
Right.
Now the problem here is hip examination is so huge that I am now doubting whether I'll do it in the second part. It will go to part three now.
Right.
So that's what I feel. But I definitely look into this request what he has made. General physical examination, I think I'll present it as a different topic.
Yes, sir.
You know, or after the hip examination, maybe I'll take it in extended phase, so that will be useful for all joint examination, whether hip, knee, spine, or shoulder. You know, the general physical examination relevant to the entire orthopedics. So I'll take it like that.
Right, sir.
I'll present a different talk on that.
Right, sir. I think today we have only this much time for discussion and question answers. We'll continue this in the next talk. 2 weeks from now.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Thank you, Shyam. Thank you all the students who joined. Hope you please add and please make a list of the doubts what you have, the controls what you face in your presentations in the department, and pass it on to Ashok Shyam. Let him compile it, forward it to me. I will, if I know, I will answer you, or I will contact other seniors and try to get the best possible answer, so that you will have a comprehensive, impression about various parts, conclusions, what I face and what students are facing the examination regarding the hip joint.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm putting it off.
Just a minute, sir.